Good evening. Thanks for joining us tonight. Big medical news from Mayo Clinic today that affects all of us. It has to do with second opinions and new research that proves getting one could be life-saving.
Their research shows that 88% of patients coming to them for a second opinion get a different diagnosis. Carol Evans' Jay Olstead has our top story.
Joan Raby is spring cleaning, something many of us have experienced.
Exactly.
But Joan tells a story that Mayo Clinic says many people have experienced too.
Thought, oh, geez, I'm just sort of stuck with this problem.
Joan had surgery on her foot, but she says she wanted the surgery fixed. Her surgeon, she said it couldn't be done.
So I went to a second doctor who said, oh yeah, we can fix that.
And according to a new Mayo Clinic study released this week, she's not alone.
Well, I think the message is that second opinions are useful.
The study found that nearly 90% of referrals who came to Mayo Clinic for a second opinion, the Mayo changed the original diagnosis in some way. More specifically, 66% of the patients received a refined diagnosis, but the study says primary care providers got it pretty close.
But 21% of the patients, the diagnosis was wrong and completely changed.
About one in five, we came up with a pretty different or completely different diagnosis.
Dr. Robert Lohr is the study's co-author and says the mistake usually comes down to the primary care provider not having the time or the resources to get it right the first time.
It surprised me a little bit that it was as high as it was.
He also believes the study is an indication that physicians and other primary care providers, including himself, need to be willing to collaborate with others.
There are other resources available and they don't have to struggle with things.
For Joan Raby, it's another indication why she tells people, don't be afraid to ask your doctor for a second opinion.
They're people too.
But Dr. Lohr adds the Mayo Clinic gets some of the toughest cases and has more resources to deal with them. By the way, the researchers didn't find much of a difference in success rates between physicians, nurse practitioners, or physicians' assistants.
Interesting information, but the bottom line is you can get a second opinion and it's a good idea.
And oftentimes doctors say, please do
it. Yeah. All right. Thank you, Jay.
Yep.
Thanks so much, everyone, for watching. We've got an epic lineup tonight of speakers.
We got an awesome panel here.
Amazing group of functional doctors, technology activists, for here for a leap forward in medicine.
This is a great gathering.
You know, our goal is to make it easy for practitioners to learn in community. There's a lot of community happening tonight. I want to say welcome to all of the communities that are watching at home.
This ecosystem that has been set up by the meetup groups, we believe will be the future ecosystem of this evolved primary care network that we are looking to develop, and it all revolves around you.
There's an exponential potential to the future of medicine. This is an allopathic conversion machine that we have just created. And it has exponential potential because it can be seen by a billion people at no extra cost. That's the beauty of the internet.
Welcome to the Functional Forum, live from Minneapolis, Minnesota. Thanks for joining us in the charge to accelerate the evolution of medicine. Please welcome your host, James Maskell.
Hey, everyone. Welcome to the Functional Forum. So glad to have you. So glad to be here in Minnesota. It's an absolute treat. Thank you so much for taking time out of your evenings to come and be part of this community. We really appreciate it. We're going to be talking tonight about the evolution of primary care. So far this year, we've been focusing on the evolution of the specialties. So we've looked at oncology and neurology and psychiatry, cardiology. Now, the sort of the theme that's been running through all of these is if we could do a better job at primary care and go upstream, we wouldn't have so many people being sent down into sort of this more expensive specialty part of medicine. But now, tonight, we're going to take the bull by the horns and really talk about where is the leverage point for serious healthcare transformation. And we believe that it sits in this primary care space. Might look a bit different than you think, so get ready for that, but I'm really excited to share. So first of all, I just want to give a shout out to all the meetup groups. We've got obviously the people in here, but if you've watched Functional Forum before, you know that the majority of people are watching at home, live streaming. So meetup.functionalforum.com is the place that you need to go to start a meetup, and it's super cool to see the evolution of the meetups. You know, at the beginning, the meetup was all about watching live, and there are, you know, dozens of meetups that are watching live now, but there are also lots of meetups that meet other times in the week, other times in the year, in Europe and Africa, for instance. Right now it's the middle of the night, so they have their meetings other times. I was just in Australia recently, and incredible to go to Australia for the first time since I've been in this job or this role, and just to meet lots of people who apparently know me very well. So it's really, really fun for that. So here's some of the pictures of people, just to give a shout out to a few. Here's North Carolina, Charlotte, North Carolina. These guys are in Clifton, New Jersey. This is in Manila in the Philippines. So in the Philippines, it's 8 in the morning, tomorrow morning, so they can watch it. This is actually part of their grand rounds, a bunch of physicians watching there. I think this is in Atlanta, Georgia. But yeah, all over, I just want to give a shout out to all the meetup hosts. And then there's one host in particular that deserves a special mention, Dr. Cynthia Thake. And she gets a special mention because she is doing the Los Angeles meetup tonight. And it's exciting to me because I actually live in Los Angeles, and so I'm glad to see one really exploding. But here is a physician that took it upon herself to really take responsibility for building it. She has 10 sponsors. She has 110 people showing up tomorrow night in Los Angeles. And it's just an incredible to see someone to grab it by the horns. Now, the really exciting thing is, even before she's done her first meetup, because her first meetup's tomorrow night, she's already surveying the population. And this is the exciting thing that we're seeing in the meetups, is that those meetups that have got an initial group of people together, but then stand in front of that group and say, hey, this isn't about us, this is about you. What do you want out of this experience? What should this meetup be about? We're starting to see that those meetups really have the most staying power and growth. And so we're really excited to see this surveying. So, you know, some people are coming for the networking, the education, business building, building community or otherwise. It's really exciting to see the different types of practitioners. We've got NDs, nutritionists, MDs, acupuncturists, all coming together into community. This is just one of the meetups. So part of the reason why we came to Minneapolis was because we'd had a very successful meetup here last year and continuing meetups, and I know that there's a really strong community here. So you see that 18.5% of people wanted something other than those choices. It's probably the wine, honestly. We've really excited to be partnering with Dry Farm Wines. If you're in America, unfortunately, they don't ship to Canada. But if you have a meetup of more than 20 people, we will be Dry Farm Wines will be sending you some of their low sugar, suitable for diabetics, biodynamic and organic wine. So if you build a meetup and you get 20 people, let Anne or Nicole know from our community, and they will ship you a bunch of wine to have the best meetup ever. So we're going to be talking about the evolution of primary care tonight, and I just want to start with this graph. So this graph is actually taken from Dr. Craig Tanio, who did a presentation back in November. It was the night before the election, and he was just really talking about where we're going to go in the next few years. So chronic disease represents 86% of total healthcare costs, according to the CDC, and this is actually a cool graph because it shows what percentage of the cost is being taken up by all these different issues. And so, you know, what he showed, and these are all from his slides, is that the primary care that we're moving towards, however you look at it, is value-based care. How do we find value in the system? And without meaning to go into too much of a boring maths lesson, you can see here that value is going to be achieved where we have really strong outcomes and really low cost. And we want to try and get the outcomes as high as possible and the cost as low as possible. We're going to be talking throughout this session about what the future of value-based care, primary care, looks like. Because if you understand this equation, you start to see that a lot of things that we've been doing, the really expensive drugs and surgeries and even physician visits, are costly. And so it means that they're not particularly well set up for value-based care. They have to deliver really strong outcomes off those interventions. One of the big things we're going to be talking about is actually tracking our outcomes, and Christy's going to be talking about that a little bit later. So just hold on to that equation because we're going to be coming back to it later. So this is actually statistics from the Oregon legislature, where they basically showed that an investment in primary care reduces costs all the way down through the system. And so particularly the primary care that we're going to be talking about here today, but you can make significant cost savings in the rest of the system by investing in primary care. And so this was actually the slide that he came up with back in November, and I think it speaks really what we're talking about today. So more investment in frontline care, whether it be primary care, health coaching, home-based care, and root cause approaches to care, multiplied by 21st century delivery models. We're going to be talking about that tonight. Technology, so we're going to talk about telemedicine, other ways to sort of reduce the costs of entry, time and also professional development and redesign care models. Really excited to have Dr. Sachin Patel making his debut on the Functional Forum tonight. I think he's running one of the most innovative practices in North America. I'm really happy he's going to be here to share. And if we do that, we can hit the quadruple aim. Now, you may have thought there was only a triple aim, but there's actually four. And that's lower costs, higher outcomes, and then both patients and providers being satisfied with the outcome. And there is the potential for that with inside functional medicine. We just have to try and hit that quadruple aim. And I think what we're going to see today is there's the potential to do that. So first and foremost, I'm here to introduce my first speaker tonight. Very excited to feature someone who is an educator, speaking to doctors all across America and the world, educating on this new paradigm of functional medicine. If you're watching at home, you can send a question on Twitter using hashtag Functional Forum. Christy and the rest of the speakers will be on a panel at the end. And so we'd love to hear your questions if you're watching live. Also in the audience, I can go around with the mic, but if you've got Twitter as well, you can jump the line. Just use hashtag Functional Forum and I'll be monitoring that. So a warm welcome to our first speaker. She is a naturopathic doctor. She is an educator for the Institute for Functional Medicine and a Minnesota local. Please give a warm Minnesota welcome to Dr. Christy Hughes. Baby, I can make you feel good.
It's exciting to watch the opening videos because I think I actually know almost every single person that was in every single shot in all of those videos. So it's wonderful to be here. It's a real, true honor. I have the privilege of opening up the discussion for us tonight to talk about where are we going in primary care today. And so I also have the honor to introduce and really hold the space for the functional medicine movement. So as an appointed faculty and also now a director of medical education at the Institute for Functional Medicine, it's a real pleasure and joy to get to watch the movement happening on a global platform. It's truly exciting to see practitioners of all types embrace again the science, but also the art of doing effective and really good medicine. So this trickles down to our discussion and our coordination back to primary care. So I can tell you, I have the honor of sitting through all of our boot camp courses, the Applied Functional Medicine and Clinical Practice course, where practitioners come in and they get ready to dive into a 40-hour program that week, and things just start to break down. It's interesting. The thoughts that they knew about medicine start to challenge them, and you can sort of watch these waves of emotion that grip and grab practitioners as they go through this entire week where they're being asked to stop and just think about, what are they doing in medicine today? And what are they treating? And where are they going next? And you know, functional medicine asks every single provider to do just that. So we leverage and base our approach in functional medicine off of a roadmap. And that roadmap is an interesting roadmap because it's really that of following the aspects or the principles of being a grounded, solidified, healthy individual, planted firmly in the ground below you, and bearing fruit and holding a space of solidity in this world. So in functional medicine, we use the image of the tree. The tree represents the healthy individual that's anchored firmly into lifestyle attributes. And there's some valuable tools that we use when teaching practitioners and physicians, as well as some very powerful and impactful tools to help our patients understand why we're utilizing those. Now, I'm going to shine the light on tonight as well what we call the heuristic or the governing operating system that drives all functional medicine providers. And it's this simple summary. It's called go to it. So can I ask you to say that with me? Are you ready? We're going to go to it. No, that was not very good. Can we try that one more time? All right, ready? Go to it. In functional medicine, practitioners, regardless of their background, whether you're visiting with a naturopath or you're talking with a medical doctor, you're working with a nurse practitioner, or it's an acupuncture that's been trained in functional medicine, the functional medicine movement helps to create this language, this flow, or this organization so that all providers who sit down at the table together are thinking through the same flow, the same organization process to move forward. So I'm just going to shine the light on two key tools tonight that are a part of our gathering and our organizing. So we're going to gather this medical information in a very unique way that's very specific to the functional medicine principles. And then we take all this information we've pulled in and then we organize it. And we put it together in this very unique model that's called the Functional Medicine Matrix Model. And that particular approach to medicine is what defines functional medicine and makes it very unique as a learning methodology. So just to pause for a moment and think about where we're going. If you do what you've always done, you'll get what you've always got. And in functional medicine, we're here to shake it up a little bit. We're here to ask our patients to stop and step back and think about how did they get to this particular point. It doesn't just happen overnight for most individuals. And in functional medicine, where we serve our communities best is in supporting them in managing and preventing chronic disease. So let's look at some of the aspects or the attributes from lifestyle medicine. Now, in gathering data, and I can say now on an international or global platform, we finally have new innovations in technology that can help us gather this important and very unique information about our patients through the concepts of functional medicine. So, for example, one of the resources that we have launched into in the last couple years is a digitized data gathering system that has this large, robust patient intake on the front end that pulls all this information together and then populates that data into these two tools I've been mentioning to you. One of them is called the timeline. The other is the functional medicine matrix. And these two tools will come to light in this digital platform. And so saving practitioners time and the ability to gather information is part of where we're going in this new era. We need to be able to show proof of concept in functional medicine because doctors are seeing this in their offices every single day. We see group practices who are implementing unique group modalities and moving patients through different types of programs and getting remarkable results, reducing costs in chronic disease management. We need to capture this data. As a whole, the community in functional medicine needs to gather this data together to be able to show and demonstrate where more of the choice points are and where's the leverage in functional medicine. And you'll find for most providers it resides in lifestyle factors. Going back to diet, nutrition changes, working through sleep and restfulness, taking the opportunity to look at movement and exercise, focusing on relationships. So very important attributes. We want to gather this data, pull this together to move this aspect of primary care forward. So we now have these unique tools and resources where we can start to do this. We can communicate information to our patients, and information can end up in their emails. And in the future, their food plans will end up in their phones on their hands. And functional medicine will be working its way from the research all the way down to the patient's handheld devices, helping them implement. So we're really pushing the envelope in functional medicine with our innovative resources. We want to support the practitioners. We want to understand who this patient base is that's seeking the functional medicine doctor. So together in partnership, we can continue to move this forward in a cost-effective manner. So what has been discovered in digging deep into the data points of, who are these functional medicine practitioners? Just want to share just a small amount of data with you. In a large group study that was done last year with over 6,000 patient contact visits, it was stunning to find out that the average functional medicine patient was 44 years old. The average. And when looking at some of our interesting differentiation points with diagnoses, you can see that the average diagnosis was 6 or more at the age of 44. Stunning numbers. And looking at the prescriptive components, we wonder where the costs are coming in. Part of the costs are that we're not looking deep enough to find the sources or the causes of these problems. Mm-hmm. To be able to look at this array of these multiple diagnoses and say, what is under the surface that's truly impacting these conditions? What are our common denominators? That's one of the most remarkable things that functional medicine does, is it says, what are the common denominators? And you know what's so powerful about having functional medicine doctors with different backgrounds and disciplines work together is they're using the same language when they have these discussion points. They're using the same common theme while they're looking to find the common denominators. So interesting, when you walk in to see most functional medicine or integrative providers, most patients seeking this form of medicine are already connected to the fact that they realize through their own self-discovery and reading that the gut or the GI tract is so deeply connected to the rest of the system, right? So many of our functional medicine patients present mindfully knowing that maybe their joint pain or their skin condition traces back to and is connected to some imbalance that they're experiencing in the gut, right? So it is of no surprise when we step back and we say, well, let's look at the database and compare male and female patients. What are the number one complaints that people are presenting with? GI distress. And when we look at some of these important associations in functional medicine, when we're struggling with the integrity and the quality of the function in the GI tract, now we're looking at nutrition compromisation. Now we're worried about issues with digestion and absorption and adequate nutrient levels. Does our patient even have the right balance of their macronutrients? Are they getting enough good quality proteins, fats, and carbohydrates? Is there enough fruits and vegetables in an array that the colorful ingestion of those phytonutrients is having an impact on the way their health is moving forward? Now, these are all important questions that we'd stop and think about if we see GI distress with a patient. Like, what are some of the underlying impacts and causes? So in our population today, seeking functional medicine, these individuals are reporting challenges with aches and pains, cognitive concerns, issues with focus and concentration. They're often stiff and they're sore. Or these symptoms have been coming on for quite some time and they can't really pinpoint how it began. It's just been chronic and slow and insidious. These are some of the areas where functional medicine shines, where we may not have the most clear-cut diagnosis, but we do know how to dig deeper and get to the underlying patterns. And that's the movement in functional medicine, is to say, what are the causes or the causes of the causes? And how can we get down to that level to really transform someone's health? Now, one of the other very interesting and important aspects of functional medicine is the engagement of the practitioner in their state of mind. So we refer to this as the art of doing good medicine in functional medicine. And you'll see this huge movement is taking place actually across the platform of medicine. You'll hear special authors and speakers, for example, Dr. Elizabeth Frades, who is running the Institute for Lifestyle Medicine out of Harvard, running all the extension courses. What you're hearing out of Harvard's lifestyle medicine courses is the discussion of the coach approach, the critical role that the physician moves out of the space of being a dictator, telling the patient what to do, but rather engaging them in a therapeutic encounter and ensuring that a coach approach in the conversation is happening. And when the physician takes a coach approach and moves that locus of control back in the space of the patient, transformations happen. Movement starts to shift. So functional medicine takes the time to put the practitioner in the right space, heart, mind, and soul, to be prepared, to be ready, to walk into that door and meet that patient in that space of receptivity, being able to hear and listen, continue to go further. So gathering plays a critical role, gathering of the practitioner to ensure gathering of the information or the insight from within that consult or that conversation. So functional medicine stemming from the art and the science. And a real area we've been on for the last year in a lot of our training courses, and I've actually been working with patients quite a bit, is this whole concept of ikigai. Have you heard of ikigai? Ikigai is the Japanese term that stands for that which drives you out of bed in the morning, that which gets you excited, that for which you live for. So if you were going to think about your ikigai, are there things that just sort of jump right out at you, the most important things that you think about the minute you open your eyes in the morning? Right, what we see in the functional medicine movement is we see functional medicine providers tuning into the functional medicine applications and getting back to the heart and soul of why they engaged in functional medicine in the first place. Going back to medicine and the promises that they had made to themselves. If you haven't spent any time looking at ikigai, it's a very interesting intersection. And it has to do this crossover space between that which you love and that which you are good at, and your capability to reach out into the world to deliver those resources and provide things that are needed. It's a beautiful interplay of you and your inner world and your outer world finding your purpose and potential. And I can tell you, I've been having more conversations with patients about this than ever. And I'm finding the patients that get moved and shift clinically are my patients who deal with anxiety and depression and mood disorders, taking the time to dig deeper and talk about purpose. So in functional medicine, resources and tools that bind us all together in this primary care movement is the timeline and the integration of this amazing tool in helping our practitioners think their way through the uniqueness of this patient in front of them. It's this tool that's used in gathering someone's storyline, the whole history of how the patient presented at this point. This is one of the anchoring tools used in primary care and functional medicine today, so that whenever there's an associated link, maybe a nutrition professional or a health coach or maybe another referral to another functional medicine doctor, the utilization of going back to leverage this tool and this resource to understand the patient's journey is a part of our common denominator. It's part of our language. that helps us understand where did the patient begin and how have they moved to this particular point today. Now, in the functional medicine architecture, you'll also hear that one of the binding principles that drives this intake and the uniqueness of us uncovering the patient's journey and story comes back to and tracks back to these considerations called antecedents, triggers, and mediators. And we plot these back onto the patient's timeline. Now, one of the unique things about functional medicine is we also stop and look for these huge areas, these points of demarcation in the patient's storyline that tell us something huge happened. Not that we're going to be dealing with the diagnoses that come downstream, but we're going to step back and say, what happened here on this unique patient's journey that we want to focus on? So I want to show you the timeline of a patient I recently just saw back in my office. It had been almost 9 years since I had seen her in person. She came back to see me this last year, 54-year-old female. She was down to 225 pounds. She had lost 30 pounds since the last visit we had together, but was describing all sorts of fatigue concerns, aches and pains. She was dealing with disruptions in her sleep pattern and challenges with blood sugar regulation. And if you look at this list, she actually came in feeling better than when I had seen her years before. Right? And looking at the severity of this list, there was red flags all over. And instead of focusing on these areas, she actually ended up spending the majority of this first visit talking to me about her stress. And when I lit up her timeline, this is the digitized living matrix version of her timeline, you could see this huge cascade, this point in her life when everything began and things started to summate. This is an example of one of these unifying tools. This is the timeline, with a very exaggerated version of what happens when we dig deeper and deeper and go into these spaces to say, well, what happened in this cascade of events? So this is a very important concept and tool that's used in functional medicine, it's used with patients, and it's used in self-care. It's used in self-care training courses for nurses, for coaches, for healthcare providers and residents to step back and think about your own timeline, to think about your own patterning. Looks like my slides have... that I don't recognize. What should I do? My timer stops when that happens, right? So in the model of the functional medicine matrix, what you will notice is that there's really three main areas. One is the delicacy and the art in which we engage in a conversation with patients. It's called the therapeutic encounter. Second is the base of the matrix, which is referred to as the modifiable lifestyle factors. This is one of the very unique things of lifestyle medicine and functional medicine both. They dive deep. These types of providers dive deep down into the lifestyle and really start there to see what is going to change, what will be transformed for these individuals if they happen to get the right amount of sleep, when they happen to create the right healthy relationships, or figure out how to handle and manage the unhealthy relationships. Just thinking here, do you have any relationships in your life that feel kind of toxic? Is there anybody you know that makes you feel kind of sick when you're around them? Right? So, I mean, sometimes the conversations we're having with patients at this level of lifestyle have to do with relationship and community and healing, helpful relatedness. The healthcare provider is a part of that care team. So in the functional medicine model, you've got the therapeutic encounter, you've got the modifiable lifestyle factors, and then the third area of great interest to physicians and primary care has to do with the clinical imbalances that stem back to what's referred to as systems biology. And this is what's new and unique that's been emerging over the last couple decades in medicine. And it's not just looking at the disease individually. It's not just looking at an independent individual organ, but rather stepping back and being able to look at the way multiple organs work together in a system, in a biological base. So it's referred to as systems biology. And so the unique aspects or those attributes of being able to identify and continue to move forward with a unique patient have to do with us saying, okay, for this patient, what is their base? How well have they taken care of themselves? We move ourselves back up into the trunk of that individual, and that's where systems biology and our genetic predispositions reside. So in functional medicine, what is so unique and cutting edge that's impactful and effective that's bringing the life force back into physicians? It's them getting to step back and say, what are the causes of disease? And learning how to find them and understand the pathophysiology and to be able to connect the dots to recognize patterns that weren't viewed through the previous lens. So in functional medicine, it's stepping back and saying, we're not just going to deal with that one limb that is dead with all those leaves that need to be pruned, but it's stepping back and saying, what can we do to tend the patient? What do we need to do to shift the soil? So as I highlighted for you, some of the key areas that we focus on are sleep, rest, relaxation. We target some of the areas of movement, therapeutic exercise. These modifiable lifestyle factors include healthy foods, the appropriate, right, live foods. And then in looking at stress and our resilience, our ability to cope with and handle and manage the stressors today. These are very important conversations. And interestingly, when we teach physician groups and patient groups, we often find that some of the biggest stressors are being experienced by healthcare providers and physicians when looking across all the various different demographics. So occupationally, physicians, becoming a physician is a very high-risk choice. And then last, when we look at relationships, we look at the importance, the power of those healing, healthy relationships, which sometimes actually stem from and happen inside of the practice. Some practitioners are opting or choosing to run these particular types of programs. So when we look at the youth, the support that comes from joining together teams, this can happen in a practice. This is part of the movement. This is part of the success, is bringing community and bringing that sense of tribe into the practice. This is a part of where healthcare is going. It's in group medicine, patient education, helpful healing connections. I'm sure many of you have seen, just in the course of this last year, the discussions going on around the concerns with loneliness or the associations with addiction to feeling isolated. These are important aspects for the healthcare provider to step forward with. So in my closing comments, I would say that where the needle is going, or as Jeff Bland would say, skating to where the puck is going down the ice. You've got all these ways of thinking about where is medicine moving? Where is this value coming from? This value is coming from physicians doing the best job with their clinical decision making and being empowered with the understanding of treating the cause or the cause of the cause. Where is this movement going and why is it so powerful? Because there's common denominators. Points of language that are used to help providers on a team understand each other. And it's also taking the time to not only look at the unique aspects of that particular patient, finding that common theme, and then engaging the right mix of providers. It's taking the time to put the patient in the center of care and drawing in all of the right appropriate team members to be able to support and usher that patient on their learning journey. So in functional medicine, our future and our movement and where the value is bringing together the collaborative care team model, empowering the patient to make the right choices, getting information and knowledge into the tips of their hands, empowering that patient to be able to move forward and treat the cause of their causes. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Christy. Beautifully said. So many things that I'd love to follow up on there. We have got a tight show tonight, but I think this is a beautiful model to sit with. You know, part of the reason why we wanted to get the meetup groups going is to introduce practitioners who could be part of this model to each other. It could be a lonely profession to do integrative and functional medicine over the last 30 years because we were a little bit weird, right? Not accepted by the mainstream of medicine. And so you had to work hard to find these kind of providers. But the good news is that it's happening faster and faster than ever. Practitioners getting together in communities like this. We've got things are blowing up on the Twitter. It's Winston-Salem, North Carolina for their debut tonight. We got Indiana. There's people from all over the country getting together and creating these kind of tools. Now, the one thing I just want to say, you know, I love integrative medicine. I know there's a strong, rich history of integrative medicine in this area, particularly not due to, you know, anyone in particular, but some people in this room have had a pretty important impact. Thank you, Penny, for being here. But the one thing I do want to say about integrative medicine that sort of potentially has the potential to sort of hold back the movement is that no one's doing the same thing. Right, that you could line up the best 10 integrative doctors and they're all integrating standard of care and non-standard of care modalities, but doing it differently and have a different system, which is fine. That's the art and science of medicine, but it's going to stop us scaling up and we need to scale up. And so the thing that I love about the functional medicine movement, here's a naturopath doing it, here's a chiropractor doing it, here's a physician doing it, a common language. You can't grow a community if you don't speak the same language. Now, you might be thinking functional medicine, you know, it hasn't got the mainstream credibility that it needs to be that common language. Well, guess what's happening tomorrow morning at 7 a.m. Mm-hmm. from the Cleveland Clinic. Dr. Jeffrey Bland is giving grand rounds. And I said in my email, this is a moment in history. This is a moment where someone who has 10 pages dedicated to him on Quack Watch is giving, is giving, you know, the grand rounds, a PhD giving grand rounds at the most famous hospital probably in the world. So just a quick, get ready, set your alarms early, because it's 7 a.m. Eastern, 6 a.m. Central. I think they're replaying it at 10 a.m. But here's what Jeff has to say about what he's going to be talking about tomorrow.
You know, for so long, we all learned algorithms that we memorize on recitation, like these are the presenting signs and symptoms of this disease, which then gets a certain diagnostic code for which then a specific treatment is then suggested. And that model was very useful when we were dealing with acute illness, and we were just looking at kind of emergency interventions. But as we've seen the rising tide of chronic disease, these complex disorders become the dominant conditions of our age, not just in the Western world, but in the developing world as well now, where non-infectious diseases are the dominant world global problem of healthcare. Things like diabetes and dementia and cardiovascular disease and autoimmune diseases. Those concepts of single explanations for a disease go away, and now we have to be dealing with the complexity of the systemic change that an individual is undergoing from a systems biology approach. And how does that then ultimately translate itself into healthcare? It translates itself into healthcare in asking a different series of questions that give us a different series of answers that are related to the system of disturbance in that individual. That is 21st century medicine, and that is the functional medicine model.
So yeah, tomorrow morning, get up early or log in and be there. The Grand Round series have been amazing. We've had so many great doctors on there, and that's going to be another great session. So, you know, we're talking about the evolution of primary care. We're talking about primary care evolving to meet the new demands. And you can see the new demands are different types of diseases. And that's why we believe that the functional medicine operating system will be the operating system for the future of medicine. But what will the rest of it look like? So on Friday, I had the opportunity to be in San Francisco at the annual HINT Summit. Now, HINT is one of the vendors that we recommend. It's a technology that's empowering this new kind of care called direct primary care. And direct primary care is essentially concierge medicine without the insurance. So patients pay the doctors directly, a low monthly rate. And this is having its own moment in the sun, quite outside of functional medicine. The DPC movement now has laws in 26 states, I think 22 states, maybe 26 states, that give it coverage. But what we need, if you learn anything from that very first video where primary care doctors don't have enough time to listen and to do what they're saying, you need a way to get time with patients. And when you've got that time, what are you going to do? Just listen for a bit longer and give the same drugs? Or you're actually going to engage the patient in their care? So it's interesting that the direct primary care movement and the functional medicine movement are sort of happening in parallel at about the same speed. But the cool thing is that they're coming together, because I was there, Tom Blue was there, and a bunch of other people. And you could see that those practices that were combining the membership model and functional medicine were growing quickly and growing quicker and adding patients more quickly. One of the things they realized, they started out, they wanted to create a technology that just solved the root cause. But what they found is that you can't get results without a provider. So the providers are super important. So what they're doing is not clinical innovation, but it's business model innovation. And you need a new business model if patients are going to be participatory in their care. And that's what we're going to talk about here for the rest of it. So we created at the Evolution of Medicine this program called the Membership Practice Builder, designed to help practitioners who are looking to build the membership model. If you go to goevomed.com/MPB, you can find out more about how to position, plan, and launch a membership-based practice. So imagine it gets sunny and all your patients go away to the lakes or whatever, and you still get paid, even if you're not doing anything, because you're on a monthly membership. That is, a lot of practices are moving in that direction. We also, at the Evolution of Medicine, have created a program called the Accelerator to deal with the inefficiencies of functional medicine. One more thing I want to share is, like, the functional medicine operating system, thank God for Living Matrix coming along and creating a technology where we could track all of those outcomes. But ultimately, if we have physicians doing hour and a half consults for every patient, we're going to run out of time. And so in this, we're talking about ways to accelerate it. Is Kara Parker here today? She lives here. So she is on the, it's all right. She has She was on the podcast this week. She's a physician here at the Whittier Clinic and is doing these group visits and it's really powerful, the peer-to-peer support. We'll talk a bit more about that later. But there's innovation in primary care and functional medicine delivery happening right here, right now in Minneapolis. So we're going to have our next speaker. So talking about innovation in business model, very excited to welcome to the stage someone. It's not his functional forum debut. A couple of years ago when we were at the IFM conference, he gave a one-minute tip that has traveled all around the internet because it was so succinct and so beautiful. That day he spoke about helping patients to find joy was the number one clinical recommendation that he would have for practitioners. We started doing this thing last year called The Future of Functional in 5, which is a five-minute talk about the future of functional medicine with no slides. And he's got a very innovative practice. It's the coolest name of a practice that I've ever heard. If you go from Mayo Clinic for your second opinion, you go to Dr. Thomas Sult for your third opinion. Here's Dr. Thomas Sult.
So we were talking about stress a minute ago. I think the definition of stress is a whole bunch of people looking down at you. So here we are. I was asked to talk about the evolution of my practice and how I got from being a run-of-the-mill family doctor to doing functional medicine. But before I do that, I see some silver tops, I see some silver chins like me, and then I see some people that look like there might be 12. I'm not... medical students here? No medical students? That's a shame. Medical-ish? Does that mean? So that's a Minnesota term. That means that it's really nauseating. nurses? Great, fantastic. Chiropractors? I don't know. Who else? Nurse practitioners, maybe? What do they call, what do you guys, we call them providers? Any providers? any other specialties or? Nutritionists? Pharmacists? What did you say?
Health coaches.
Health coaches, awesome, health coaches. Shiatsu, I need you badly. Say it again?
Colon hydrotherapy.
All right, so there's a big variety here. So I went to medical school. I applied to 42 U.S. medical schools and didn't get a single interview. And after that ego building exercise, I went to Grenada in the West Indies for 2 years. And there's a little story before that, but I'll start here. In Grenada, I became very interested in the local healing tradition. There's they call them bush doctors, and I always thought that meant like, you know, in the Aboriginal sense, the outback. It doesn't. It means herbology, because they use bush. They use the bush. And I became very interested in that, and I lived with a family in Grenada that was interested in preserving the culture despite a lot of progress, in quotations. So I was able to go out with these shaman and these bush doctors and watch them do all kinds of interesting things and help people get better. And yet it was in really diametrically opposed to what I was learning in Dr. Shahid's biochemistry class. It was all about pathways, you know, very linear and very reductionistic. And then I had the great fortune to transfer to UCLA. And I was just a run-of-the-mill third-year medical student coming into UCLA as a transfer student, and I got invited, as all of the third-year medical students did, to Norman Cousins' home for dinner. And for those of you who don't know, Norman Cousins was a writer. He became the first director of the Office of Psychoneuroimmunology at UCLA. And in those days, you couldn't say holistic medicine, or you couldn't, those were all bad words. You had to have a big multisyllabic word. So psychoneuroimmunology. And for years, I described myself as a psychoneurogastro, endocrino, you know, et cetera-ologist, because I was afraid of the word holistic, because it was a bad word. And now we have integrative. And integrative means we take the worst of both. No, we try to take the best of both, and we bring them together. So I had this conversation, and it will not be, I was going to point out a specific person, but I'll say to any of the people here who know me, it won't be that surprising to find out that I got into an argument with Norman Cousins on our first visit. Because he said that the purpose of medicine is to save life. And I said, there's an ICU on every floor of the Center for Health Sciences at UCLA that can do that. And it's not always the best option. There are reasons why you might not want to be kept alive. There are ways to keep people alive that may not be in the patient's best interest. So I just didn't think that was it. I think that there's a bigger reason. And I think it is to help people have joy. I think it's to help inspire people to live in awe and live in compassion. And if we can figure out how to do that, it turns out that we can raise the level of wellness to the point where disease can't flourish. And that is the whole point of functional medicine. Functional medicine is looking at the other side of the coin. I always tell people when they say, well, what do you do exactly? I'm not entirely sure. What I do is exactly what the Lipitor commercial says to do. After a trial of diet and lifestyle, consider Lipitor. If you do the first part properly, you don't have to do the second part. I have 5 seconds to finish. So taking those ideas forward, I started looking for a way. How do you bring this forward? And a patient of mine introduced me to Jeff Bland. And from there, we kind of evolved this thing called functional medicine. So functional medicine is very simply this. If you have a disease, we're looking at it from this direction. What's the disease? Aha, here's the diagnosis. Now that we know the diagnosis, we have a prescription. And there, you know, there's all you got to do is look online. If you've got X disease, there's, you know, organizations that'll tell you how to treat it. It's really monkey business at that point. The question of functional medicine is, how do we raise the level of wellness so disease can't flourish? And that's really what we're trying to do. And how did I get to that point? Well, I started by being a regular old family doctor. And by the way, I read the nurse's note, here's your amoxicillin. Oh, I read the nurse's note, here's your antihypertensive. I read the nurse's note here. You know, that's how it works, unfortunately, for many of us who are in high pressure, high volume practices, which I was in. And I started having treatment failures. Like, I didn't take the medicine. Why didn't you take the medicine? Well, because it made me sick. Well, but which do you like? This is what I used to say. Which do you like more, the side effects of the medicine or a stroke? You know, my way or the highway, right? That didn't work that well, it turns out. But it worked pretty well because those people said, what an arrogant prick, and they left. They went somewhere else, right? So instead, I thought, well, gosh, maybe there's a moment in time here. Maybe there's a moment in time where when they don't do what I ask, I can say, oh, how come? And they can tell me, and maybe that can be a collaborative therapeutic intervention. Oh, you can't take that. Well, what could we do? What could we do? And you start to think about it together. What could we do? And all of a sudden, it turns out that they can walk. So they start walking. Or we start doing group visits and one person says, I just can't motivate myself. And the person who's already got it together says, hey, I'll walk with you. That's the beauty of a health coach. My health coach does virtual walks. She walks along with her phone like this and talks to everybody who's on her Zoom hangout thing. And even if they're not walking, it reminds them, right? So there's a lot of things that we can do that are very simple, that don't have to get into the really nerdy stuff, and can be very, very powerful. So the evolution of my practice is very tiny little steps that go from understanding that just because they don't come back to me anymore doesn't mean they're cured. That's the first understanding that I think many of us as physicians don't understand even now, to, oh, maybe part of the problem is me because I'm being an arrogant so-and-so, to how can we fix that problem? And that's really the evolution of my practice, and I think probably of all of our practices who do this. Thank you.
You know, if you, Christy and Tom are both delivering functional medicine, but if you dip into both of their practices, you'll see now the micro practice environment, which you've spoken about, the low overhead model, and then use of health coach and use of technology, and that's some of the innovative delivery systems that we're going to be talking about. So I want to come back to this equation and talk a little bit more about it because, you know, having looked out, we're in a really unique position at the evolution of medicine where we can look out and see all of the different practices that are delivering this care and see what the best practices are. And what we need to get good at is start to thinking in these terms, because the way that we actually delivered dollars in the past in medicine was actually basically cost times the number of patients. You did this many stents to this many patients, that's what we're going to reimburse you. But now cost is coming below the line. So there's a real focus on delivering things that don't cost a lot. And guess what? That's most of our stuff. If you really want, if you believe that functional medicine is expensive, compare it to Humira or a colostomy bag or anything else that you're using or an operation or otherwise. This stuff is low cost and the outcomes are strong. And so what I've done is looked at, if you compare what a regular functional medicine practice has looked like up until now, what can we do to create a value-based care practice? So this is what I'm calling the clinical structure for value-based care, and this came to me while I was in Australia. So I was sitting in Australia when this came to me with a 15-person provider team. 15 providers sitting around once a week. They got 6 patients in an inpatient facility. Shout out to Marcus and the rest of the people in Byron Bay. But it was amazing to watch 15 of them discuss a case. 5 physicians, all these other providers, and it was just incredible. So most practices, what you want at the middle of it is a core. So that's either going to be your integrated provider team, like Christy was sharing, or it could be a mentorship community. Tom and Christy are members of a Facebook group for practitioners, functional medicine practitioners, where people put their cases and you get a lot of people coming together. Now, core is good. Lots of different eyeballs on the same practice case is good. But it's expensive, right? You've got to have all those practitioners times X dollars per hour. It's the most expensive thing that we could do. So that's why it's at the middle and not on the outside. So core is the central, and I suggest that everyone find themselves a core, whether it's a mentor or join one of the Facebook groups where you can actually get feedback from other providers in real time. The second thing is care. So now you've got that core team. What is the care that they actually provide? Now, up until a few years ago, the only practices we saw had these two things. You had the providers, and then you had the care that those providers provided to the patients that came in. And I don't think this is particularly well set up for value-based care, but I think if we can add a few elements to it, we could build on this foundation to create a practice that's really built for value-based care. So the next level out is coaching, and particularly health coaching. And why I think the functional medicine health coaches are really well positioned in the future is because they speak the same language. We heard Christy talking about the secret same language. So, you know, just to put this into context, if you've got a patient with type 2 diabetes and they need to make behavior changes, if we go back to value equals outcomes divided by cost, if the doctor's $300 an hour and the health coach is $30 an hour, is the doctor 10 times better at getting outcomes for that thing than the coach? And the answer is like, definitely not. Maybe not even better at all, right? And not 10 times better, but that's the equation that you're looking at when you look at the value-based care equation. So a layer of coaching between patients and the core care team, and Sachin's gonna talk a little bit about how he does it, but coaching is a really important part. If we wanna get behavior change, we need people trained in behavior change. The next level is community. So community is really strong. I mentioned Dr. Kara Parker, but group visits is one example. Sachin talks about some of the way that he's doing it. The power of peer-to-peer interactions goes beyond what Tom was saying. Yes, it can motivate someone, you know, someone who's been through this process, telling someone else about that process can be more motivating than any provider. But the cool thing about community is a peer-to-peer transaction has zero cost. There is zero cost, and we don't have to go back to maths to know that if you put zero at the bottom, then value is infinity, right? So think about what are the lowest cost interventions that we can do. And then the outer ring that I'm going to put on here is content. And so we have the founding editor of the Experience Life magazine, Pilar, here this evening. I'm not sure if content has ever been thought about as a part of medicine, but it clearly is. You know, Kara Parker, when she's doing her group visits, the first thing she does, she gives a four-week training on all the basics of keeping yourself well. So here we have this five-step process that I think is the future of value-based care. And if you look at it from the patient perspective, how do you come into this practice? You don't get to the core straight away, right? Because how do you, is it even worth it? You don't want to be spending that. The first thing you come into contact with is content. And that could be the stuff you're putting out via social media. It could be what's on your website. It could be your email series. Content is free, and there are some people that just don't know anything, and if a little bit of content could get them well, and that's free at zero cost. The next thing, The next thing is community. Again, Sachin's going to talk about how he does it, but inviting people who have engaged with your content into a situation where you can introduce people who want to be healthy to each other. Right? The most powerful thing that you could ever do is introduce two people who want to get healthy to each other, because they'll be accountability buddies. And again, it's no cost, but it's so much value for you. The third is coaching. You know, how do we provide an opportunity for all the lifestyle stuff and the coaching to be done by a provider at the lowest possible cost before you get into the care of a provider, particularly a physician, and then the core? So think about this as you're developing your practice, because this equation is not going away, right? Obamacare had value-based care. Whatever Trump care looks like will be value-based care. International is moving to value-based care because they realize the incentives are insane when you pay people for what actual work they do, because they do all the wrong stuff, all the stents and none of the exercise or walking groups, right? So this is the equation for the way that medicine is going, and we need to create practices that are designed around this structure. So, with all that, I'm very excited to welcome to make his Functional Forum debut, Dr. Sachin Patel. Someone told me about him a couple years ago, and the first thing I did was to interact with his content, to follow him on Facebook. And I have never seen, I don't know any other clinic in the country that is pumping out the kind of results that the Living Proof Institute is. And I know that because I see it on Facebook the whole time. I see case studies, I see letters from patients saying how their life has been transformed. I've been to the clinic. It's in a co-working space. It's the same kind of thing, the low overhead practice. They used to have one room, now they've got six. And so, you know, I'm very, very excited to talk about innovation in delivery models, innovation in marketing. It's a great pleasure to welcome to the stage for the first time. Please give a warm round of applause, Dr. Sachin Patel.
Interesting song, right? That was a song my wife and I walked into at our wedding. So today I'm going to tell you about my other wife, my clinic. Thank you so much for having me. I want to spend a moment. I have only 18 minutes to speak, but I do want to acknowledge James, because James is somebody who puts in a lot of effort, and his team puts in a lot of effort without us actually seeing it. So if we could just give him a short acknowledgement. We don't get to see all the amazing work they do, but thank you. I appreciate you, and the profession appreciates you. So today we're going to talk about some very important things. Now, where this presentation stems from is a question that I got about 2 years ago that was actually a Facebook message to me. And the question was, and I'm going to pose it to you as well, is, what would you do if I wrote you a $250 million check to advance functional medicine? I literally got that message. And it stopped me in my tracks, because I really had to think about that. What would I do? Would I run a Super Bowl ad? Would I build a hospital? Or would I prepare practitioners for the tidal wave of patients that's headed our way? There is not a shortage of patients. And I want you to get that out of your head immediately. There is not a shortage of patients. There is a shortage of practitioners that are ready to handle the patients and provide them with a service without them falling apart. Our practices have to be ready for what's coming. Because if somebody did write that check and we did run a Super Bowl ad, what would happen to your practices? Do you have the business infrastructure in place to handle the millions of people that are sick? Who has that? Not very many people. I'm not a researcher. I don't build hospitals. I have people on my team that were building hospitals, and now they're helping us build the future of healthcare. So I applaud you all for being here, because I know it takes courage. It takes a lot of courage to leave what you were doing. It takes a lot of courage to take a $250,000 education and decide you're going to do something else. It takes a lot of courage to take a temporary pay cut from something that was comfortable, albeit you may have been getting paid to do something that wasn't congruent with your belief system. It does take courage. It takes courage to swim upstream. It takes courage to go against the naysayers, doesn't it? It takes a lot of courage for all of you, and I acknowledge you for that. So we're all courageous people, and we're all walking on this proverbial tightrope. It's important for us to be successful. It's important for our patients and our communities for us to be successful in business. Okay? This is a business. It's a business of fixing people. It's a business of fixing communities. It's the business of transforming countries. That's what we're going to do. That's what we have the capability of doing. When I realized the actual magnitude of the problem, the solution became very apparent to me. The solution wasn't for me to get as many people as possible to come into my office. The solution was for me to keep as many people as possible out of my office. If all of us functional medicine practitioners became successful overnight and flooded our practices with patients, there would still not be enough of us. That's a drop in the bucket. The existing solution and the proposed solution cannot actually fix the magnitude of the problem. So we have to create a bigger solution, a solution that actually keeps people out of our office. So that's how I've built my entire business model, is to solve that problem. And that's why I create so much content, because I want to keep people out of my office. I don't want the sickest people in my community coming to see me after they've failed all these different practitioners' care, after they've taken all these drugs, after they've tried all the different surgeries, after they've been to many other even natural healers. And one of the things that Dr. Christie talked about is that the solutions are based and grounded in lifestyle. So if we can get people to make these lifestyle changes and teach them how to make these changes, then we can give them the courage to heal themselves, because the body is capable of that. And we're proving that day in and day out. What we do as functional medicine practitioners is we find what's interfering with that innate potential. Okay? So I honor you for your courage. The next thing it takes to be successful in practice is to have congruence. And not just congruence in your diet, but in congruence with every single thing that you do. You gotta be congruent with the way you sleep. You gotta be congruent with your relationships and the people whose company you keep. You gotta be congruent with the way you exercise. You can't tell your patients to do something that you yourself are not doing. It's important as practitioners that we're also vulnerable with our patients. It makes us a lot more relatable when we tell them what our struggles are. Okay? Everyone that I know in functional medicine didn't start off in functional medicine right out of school. You usually, for the most part, had some sort of health challenge of your own. So don't hide from that. Embrace that, because then you can meet the patient where they're at. And so our practice is called the Living Proof Institute. It's not called the I read about it in a book institute or the I just learned this on the weekend institute. Right? You've got to live what you're preaching to your patients. You've got to be completely congruent in every aspect. Okay? So this is very important if you want to be successful in business. And this is why I love Facebook, because it allows me to show people that congruence. It's a free platform for all of us. Whether you like it or not, no matter how much you tell your patients to put their cell phones away and get off Facebook before bed, they're on Facebook. And you could be there right there with them, telling them to get off their phones. Communication, we find, is also very critical and extremely important. You know, this idea that people like to be communicated with the same way that you like to be communicated with is actually very incorrect. They've identified four primary communication styles. Some people like you to be direct. Some people like you to be more empathetic. Some people like you to be more cautious with the words that you use and more analytical with the words that you use. One of the things that we do on our intake form, which is quite extensive, is we actually have a communication guideline questionnaire. It's one page. It's the first page I look at when I look at my intake form, before I even look at their chief complaint. And the reason I do this is because I need to know what words to use to get this patient to change their life. And if I use the wrong words, no matter how well-intentioned I am, that person's going to walk out of my office and we're going to fail them. So very, very important. We find that a lot of stress from relationships comes from poor communication. So I will review that communication intake form with my clients and have my staff review that as well, and I will have their spouse fill out that form as well. Because if we can get their spouse communicating more effectively with them, then guess what? My job is so much easier. Isn't your job so much easier when the patient doesn't have turmoil at home? You know, I don't believe there's bad people. I believe there's bad communication and sometimes miscommunication. My wife and I are different communicators. I'm very direct. She likes to tell the whole story. So when she tells me a story, I already know what the punchline is. And I tune out because I already know the end. And so she thinks I'm ignoring her when I'm really not. Okay, so now she knows because I'm a direct communicator, she just has to tell me the bottom line. And some of your patients are going to come in that way. They don't need to know all the details. You just have to tell them exactly what to do, and guess what? They're going to do it. Some of your patients need everything step by step. So this communication guideline changed, transformed my life, and it transformed our patients' lives. Has anyone here ever done the five love languages? Wasn't that quite transformative? Yeah, it's amazing. So not only do you have to be a good communicator with your patients, but with your staff as well. Very important. If you want a well-oiled machine, you have to know the communication style and even the love languages of your staff. Some people are not rewarded by you paying them more money. And if you have a well-oiled machine, your staff is going to be there with you. If you speak their love language and reward them with their love language, they're going to hang around much longer. You're going to get way better outcomes, and it takes a lot of stress off of you as a practitioner. So communication is very critical. It's this faculty of communication that separates us from virtually every animal on the planet. So use it to your advantage. Don't let it disrupt or destroy your practice. Okay? One way to build excellent communication is to communicate. Right? Be human. Most of us have lost that ability to communicate because we delegate that communication to email and to text messages. Start communicating. Communication, vocal communication especially, stimulates the vagus nerve, which is one of the most important nerves in our body. If you want people to heal, get them to start talking. Watch what happens. Okay? Compassion. Every one of you here is compassionate. Every single one of you here is compassionate. That's why you're in healthcare. You care about people. You care about your patients. You care about your community. How do you show that? How do you demonstrate that? I show my compassion for my community by teaching them how to stay out of my office. What's more compassionate than that? I can't think of anything more compassionate than that. I can't think of anything more compassionate than teaching somebody a life skill so that they can keep their kids out of my office as well. And their grandkids. Okay? We're not all in this. Who's here for the Ferrari? Anyone here for the Ferrari? I didn't think so. Who's here to change the world? All of you, right? And we can change the world through communication, through compassion, by living our truth, through congruency. Very important, okay? And these aren't just esoteric things. These are extremely important. This is what I discovered over many years by making many mistakes, building two offices in two countries, coaching about 60 doctors, and helping them do the same thing. So I love this message. I love propagating this message as far and wide as I can. And of course, competency is very important. You have to have good clinical skills, right? When you build a practice, there has to be three things that are taken into consideration. First and foremost is patient outcomes, right? Your patients have to get better if this is going to work, if you're going to stay in business. The next thing is practice outcomes. You've got to stay in business if you want to stay in business. And the third one is practitioner outcomes. What's your health like? What time are you going to bed? What time are you waking up? What's on your mind when you wake up first thing in the morning? Does anyone here want to see a burnt-out doctor? Does anyone here want to be a burnt-out doctor or clinician? Nobody does. So competency is very important, but what I would encourage you guys to realize is that 80% of your patient's outcomes are based on things you already know. And if you can effectively communicate change to your patients, 80% of them will get better. In fact, I would argue that 80% of the patients in your practice probably don't even need to be there if they took better care of themselves. It's the 20% that actually need to be there. So competency is very critical, but I don't want you to think that just because you learn about it, you're going to use it. We need to move away from this model as practitioners because we feel incompetent all the time. Don't you feel like there's always something new coming out? How many of you feel incompetent clinically? Just be honest, be vulnerable for a moment. Most of the hands are up. And it's because there's all this new information that's constantly coming out. But here's what I'm going to tell you to do. We live in a digital age where you don't have to know everything. You just have to know where to find it. Okay? So there's a big difference between just-in-case information and just-in-time information. You're 5 minutes away from finding out any answer. So many of us will fill our heads with all this information that we may or may not ever use, and we live in this constant state of feeling incompetent. And that incompetent feeling prevents us from having the confidence that we need to get our message out there. Because we're afraid of what are people going to think. Just remember who your audience is. Your audience isn't Jeffrey Bland. Your audience isn't probably the people in this room. Your audience is that person that has no idea how to take care of their health because they've never been taught how to. Your audience is that person who's confused, that's potentially looking for you and looking at you for information. Okay? So be competent, but don't be the resource, be resourceful. Don't you all want employees that are resourceful? Your employees don't have to know everything. They have to know where to get the information from. And the same thing with you. You're an employee. You're an employee of the patient. Okay, so be resourceful. Collaboration is also very critical. Collaborating with your team. So we have health coaches. My wife, she's also a photographer and filmer. She's a pharmacist. She works in our practice. Okay, we have chiropractors. We have nurse practitioners. We have medical doctors. We all collaborate. Each one of us brings something new and different to the table, but our ultimate goal is the same, which is to help providers. What we've done is we've figured out where in the timeline of treatment each provider fits in. And so it's important if you're collaborating with a team of people that you realize and recognize where each of these people fits into the team. Okay? But don't be afraid to collaborate. And if you don't have a team, build a network within your community. If you want referrals, the best way to get referrals is to be a good referrer. Okay? Refer other people in areas that you're not competent or where other people might have greater competency. You know, get connected with yoga studios. Get connected with breathing coaches, with holistic strength coaches, with personal trainers. Because guess what? They're working with the exact same avatar that you're looking for. So collaboration is very critical. You don't have to know everything. You have to know how to build a team so that you can know as much as possible and collaborate with your community. The next one is compliance, and here's why compliance is extremely important. Compliance equals results. Results for you and the patient equals confidence. Confidence results in referrals, and referrals results in organic practice growth. Anyone can market their practice and grow it. Okay, it's just a numbers game at a certain point. Anyone can do that. But when you're growing your practice organically, that's a sign that you're doing something right. Now, what I would say is the first 50 to 100 patients are the most important. Because if these clients are compliant, you're going to get great results, you're going to boost your clinical confidence, you're going to start getting referrals, and your practice is going to start booming. But what I find a mistake that practitioners make initially is they just get excited that somebody's ready to work with them. And what they do is they'll bring anyone into their practice that's ready to swipe that card. Anyone guilty of that? I was. And so what happens? When these patients are not compliant, they don't get results. So what do? Do you ramp up your marketing? Do you ramp up your messaging? Or do you start playing small? You start playing small because now you don't have that certainty that you need to scale and grow your practice. So those first 50 to 100 patients are the most important. Be sure you safeguard those seats for the right people. Extremely, extremely valuable. Okay? It's probably the most important thing I said today. The next thing is consistency. Now, if you follow me on Facebook, how many of you follow me on Facebook? Anyone here? Okay. Great, a lot of you. Awesome. So you have to follow me. You can't add me. I've reached, apparently you can only have 5,000 friends. So follow me on Facebook, and you'll see that I'm consistently putting out as much information as possible, and I put out my best information. The reason I put out my best information is because the opposite of that is my worst information. My best information today will not be my best information tomorrow because I'm in a continuous state of growth, just like all of you. So 6 months from now, your best information will be new content. Every week, your best information is going to get better and better. So never be afraid to give out your best information. That's what your community deserves. It deserves the best of you. If I can help 5,000 people by posting a 2-minute video, that's like magic to me. Okay, it's amazing. I did a video and 17,000 people saw it. It was 5 minutes long. That's 85,000 minutes of work I did. Can you imagine that? It's like 4 months of work in 5 minutes. That's the power of the internet. So you've got some amazing content right up here. Don't be afraid. Be fearless. Go fearlessly into that night. Contribution is a big one as well. When your community wants you to succeed, when your patients and your customers want you to succeed, there is virtually nothing that can stop your business from growing. Nothing. But because you care about your community, you have to contribute within that community. So we have our team members participate in garbage pickups and cleanups. We go and clean beaches. We just finished building a clinic in Uganda. So we built about a 3,000 square foot clinic in Uganda. I don't even have my own clinic. I wanted to build one for someone else. So that's what I did first. I want to contribute. I want to give as much as I can and as much of myself as I can every single day. I wake up every day with that ikigai, which is what piece of myself am I going to give today? And if each of us watching this and each of you in here did that, think of how that would transform this world. Okay, so contribute as much as you can. And the last one, and certainly not the last one, I could talk for hours about this, but the last thing I want to talk about today is community. Community is extremely important. And the way we leverage our community is through Facebook groups. Anyone here using Facebook groups? Few of you. It's free. It's our patient incubator. So what we do is we put any prospective client into our community group. Because guess what? We've got our veteran patients in there who are ready to jump in, ready to help, ready to provide, ready to contribute, and we've got new people that feel welcome into a community. There's a big problem right now, James talked about this, which is social isolation. A prisoner would rather be surrounded by rapists and murderers and criminals than be in solitary confinement. And that's how your patients feel. They feel confined. They feel isolated. So communities are an excellent way for you to grow and scale your message and provide tremendous value to your patients and your prospective patients. Thank you.
Have a seat now. Thank you, Chaz. So we're going to bring the chairs along here. I would just definitely follow Sachin on Facebook. One other area that he uses community, which I think is so important, is that the only way to become a patient in Sachin's practice is to come through the series that we talked about earlier, the content. You see the content online. You come into the community. How does he acquire new patients? He has a event every Saturday, brings all the patients in, lectures them in a group. Sachin's marketing is amazing because instead of teaching people the five things you want to know about supplements, right, to get people excited about supplements, like the five things that you can do to never take supplements again. But guess what? You're going to have to be up on your, you know, all the other things that you talk about to not take supplements. So, you know, it's sort of a little bit reverse, but you know, check it out, do what they're doing. If you go to Living Proof Institute, goevomed.com/livingproof. I actually am also in the Facebook group of their mentorship program, which you can find out more about at this address. And the infectious enthusiasm for beautiful clinical practice is spreading from Sachin to all of his students, and I'm watching it in real time, and it's really amazing. So I just want to say one more thing before we get to the panel here. We are doing the evolution of neurology next month, but this summer I'm going to take Sachin on vacation with me. It's not really vacation, kind of work. But 2 years ago, I did a TED talk, TEDx talk in Guernsey, which is a tiny island between England and France. And Guernsey has two very interesting things going for it. One, 64,000 person population, so small population. And two, single layer of bureaucracy. It's not in the EU and it's not in the UK. It's just its own island. They can do whatever it wants. Guernsey wants to be the first country in the world to get to life expectancy 100. They want to jump past Monaco and Norway and Japan and get there first. And we are doing an event on the 30th of June. It's going to be live streamed on the Functional Forum show. Sachin and five other doctors that you've seen on the Functional Forum before will be going over there. I chose Sachin because Sachin is doing one of the most innovative things he's doing in his practice is community batch cooking. Imagine getting all the patients together that said they don't have the time to cook the healthy meals together. Put 20 of them in a commercial kitchen, have them make 20 dishes of one meal each, and they got enough food for a week if they bring their right Tupperware, and you organize that too. So here was these are the kind of innovation on the edge of community and marketing and that Sachin's doing. And so we want to bring those kind of ideas into the mainstream. So we're going to bring up the panel here. We've got all the speakers and Pilar from Experience Life. So maybe you guys can come up. Welcome.
My dream team.
We got the dream team in the house. All right, so if you've got a question, put your hands up, and I'll come down and find you. We do have some questions that are coming in from Twitter. So Pilar, I want to start with you. So I put up there a little bit ago, content as a part of medicine. And now you've been Experience Life was writing about functional medicine before anyone else. What are your thoughts as content as playing a role in the future of medicine?
Well, I think I was so thrilled to see it. I was waiting for it to come, and it gave me a happy feeling. I want to point out, too, I've got a couple of my colleagues here, Jamie Martin and Courtney Helgo, who are editor-in-chief and health editor, respectively, at Experience Life. A lot of the reason that we started Experience Life was that I didn't feel that there was any good content coming out in the mass media really addressing the root causes of people's health issues or addressing their real-life priorities. And there is a reason for that. The entire media industry is really set up to serve advertisers and publishers, not readers. So, you know, the things that you think you're interested in getting, you know, resolution to your problems, help with your daily struggles, it's really not in most publishers' best interest to actually help you solve those problems. It's in their best interest to keep you having those problems and suggesting ads with products that will promise solutions to those problems. So I will say, having worked at Huffington Post, at Experience Life, and been surrounded in the media community for a long time, there is not likely to be a wave of coverage of the most progressive solutions in medicine in our country for quite some time in the mass media. I mean, recently Maria Rodale, who runs one of the bigger health and fitness media companies in this country, Rodale, took the advertising out of Prevention Magazine because she said straight up, there is no way we can accurately cover health without taking the ads out, because the ads drive the editorial in so much of what we see. So I actually think it's really exciting. What's happening now is kind of a leapfrogging of the media industry with folks like you guys creating amazing content and going directly to consumers and saying, here's what I know, let me share this with you. That said, there's some real limitations there, which is that we still don't see as credible direct-to-consumer media for the most part. You get thrown up on Quackwatch. You know, somebody Googles you and says, oh, no, they're completely legitimate. Don't listen to anything they say. And there really is still a need for some type of credible journalism in this space to take on these questions and share this information. I'm really interested, a lot of the work I'm excited about doing, and I'm talking with folks like Penny George and others, about how to create better streams of media that leverage the really intense work that you guys are doing, educating people, but putting it through a filter that, you know, looks and sounds like professional journalism, is fact-checked and proofread, and, you know, does all the really hard things, and puts it out in a place that folks can access it pretty easily and then find their way through those content streams back to providers and practitioners and coaches who can help them integrate that information into their real lives. But I think, you know, some of the data, Christy, that you shared, you know, those charts of like GI problems that people are facing, you know, things like psoriasis and autoimmune disorders that are $40,000 a year for the Humira that's supposed to suppress the symptoms, doesn't tell you how to root cause disease, cure it at all. But if we could start helping those people through legitimate media, like the content that helps them go, oh, this is maybe actually a problem I can do something about. My doctor told me it was incurable. They don't know the cause, but here's an article that seems pretty straightforward. Maybe I could change what I'm eating. I could get some help from a practitioner that might actually point me in the direction. I think that that's a profoundly exciting possibility. And It's not likely to happen in the commercial mass media system that we have now because it's not set up with incentives for journalism to do that kind of. In fact, there are blockades against it. And we have a whole other conversation about the censorship that happens in the mass media for that kind of content.
But smells like fake news to me. Christy, yeah. You know, we've seen in the last few years that, you know, there's this little button on the top of the IFM's website, find a practitioner, and the numbers have just gone from like 200,000 to now over a million last year. Yeah. Seems to be in a certain way, like some of the summits and books, how many books have there been by functional medicine? The content's sort of making its way out there and people are finding these practitioners. But I think as Sachin said, we need a lot more and we need them to have a scalable business model because everyone just get filled up and then there's a 6-month waiting list doesn't help the guy with autoimmune disease.
Yeah, absolutely. And I think, you know, you nailed the numbers. I mean, it's just stunning when we were watching the fourth quarter presenting last year and seeing this trajectory towards a million searches on the site. That would have been unheard of. We wouldn't have even guessed that possible a few years ago. So that's a million people were on the
unique
site this
searches.
Year. Unique individual searches coming in looking to find a practitioner in their area. And so, you know, I think we also are at a tipping point where practitioners, you know, have different levels of training, you know, and there's certainly a different ways that people can move throughout their educational lifelong learning experience. So, you know, we've just made sure that we opened up a lot of opportunities and avenues, you know, supporting those at the level of health coaches, those at the level of primary care, those who are looking, you know, to connect with mentors and others in the field. I think it's amazing that, you know, I've talked a doc on a conference call with me on a development team this week said, you know, it takes most doctors 5 years to go through the entire training and feel really comfortable in functional medicine. He said, you know, honestly, it takes them that many years to feel comfortable in their own business of functional medicine. So, I mean, that's just another hot topic that's growing.
Can you quickly add to that? Because I want to ask you about that. Because I know in times gone by, you had a mega practice, and now you have a micro practice.
Yep.
What do you find being on the other side of it now?
Well, I think the biggest push for me was trying to find life balance. I mean, I absolutely.
Did you find that?
I'm working so hard on it. It's not easy yet, but. You know, I think it's because I had kids, you know, and all of a sudden with my kids, I realized with each kid that came along, there was one practice that I closed down, shut down, or sold off. So I had five practices at one point all throughout this whole area in North Dakota, and just really was getting to that point of loving this medicine so much that it actually pushed me to the verge of burnout, right? Loving what you do so much that you become exhausted doing what you love so everybody else can get better. You know, and I think in this field, the other challenge is, you know, you get lit up and get excited about functional medicine, and it doesn't like stay at the door when you walk out. You know, it doesn't stay with your charts. You know, you walk out and everywhere you go to every, you know, family gathering and every potluck and every church or, you know, faith group experience, somebody's going to corner you and say, you know, I've been having hot flashes. You know, so it's like it just doesn't end there, right? So I think the key for me was realizing that, you know.
Last night at dinner, by the way.
It happens. Or on the airplane. I just tell people I sell copy machines now when I sit down. Like, I sell copy machines and I just hope somebody doesn't sit next to me that knows anything about copy machines. But, you know, it's, I think part of the challenge is just that balance point, you know, and with functional medicine, you know, you can get to a point where it's all referral driven, right? And it's all driving people's needs. And then you got to find that touch point of how much is enough for you as a provider that you know you're making the difference, but you're not exhausted when you go home and play with your kids. That's
totally.
I think what I'm thrilled to see is in the field of functional medicine, that topic is front and center. Physicians preventing physician burnout, med students really dealing with residents, doing self-care. I mean, we as the healthcare providers need to be front.
Absolutely. Yeah, last year at the IFM conference in the back row, do you remember they had those sitting balls that you could sit and bounce on? I was like, that's progressive because sitting's the new smoking. Sachin, I know, you know, when people come into your mentorship program, the first thing that you have them do is do the health. You know, get healthy to become living proof. How much of an impact does that have to be able to like really communicate that to these, you know, the new doctors that are coming through?
Well, everything you do is an extension of yourself. So if your business is going to be successful, you have to be in life successful. And so every person that we that goes through our program actually becomes patient zero. So they get to experience what it's like to actually be, because most functional medicine practitioners kind of do it on themselves. And so you're not your best, most unbiased person to treat yourself. And I hear people laughing because you've done that before. And I was guilty of that at one point. So it's important that the patient, the doctor becomes the first patient and encounters what it's like to actually be the patient and be interviewed and to get the testing done and have somebody else give them that second or even that third opinion about their health.
I love the third opinion. I think it might be the best name in functional medicine because they're going to Mayo for the second one, right? And then they're coming to you.
Well, I was going to call it the ultimate opinion, but I thought that might be arrogant.
You're trying to get away from arrogance.
Trying to get away from arrogance.
Humility. Talk.
Yeah. You know, I think there's a lot of organizational tips, but I think the most important tip is just do it. You can get paralysis of analysis. There's all of these things that you got to do, and oh my God, what about this? And what happens if this happens? Well, if it happens, it happens, and you figure it out. And I think that's the beauty of a micro practice. I was in a big practice too. In fact, I was sort of right on the verge of getting to a functional medicine hospital out in the frozen tundra. And there were too many people with opinions, you know? It's like, this is too hard. So I kind of broke free from that and went, first I became an employee, and then turns out I'm a terrible employee. So I started a micro practice, and then now I'm resisting more partners because I'm, you know, you do the same thing over and over expecting a different result. It turns out that's insanity, so apparently I'm insane. But you build and you grow because there's so much demand. I live 2 hours west of here in a tiny little town, 900 people, and we have recently solved our problem of being booked out for a year. Now we're only booked out for about 6 months. If I can do this, if you live in a city, like, it's not, you don't have to work that hard at it. You have to be true to yourself, you know? You have to do the things that were discussed and be real and be live in compassion and be compassionate and try to foster compassion in everybody you know. And it happens because you're delivering compassionate care, and compassionate care heals. That's really what functional medicine is. Functional medicine, fundamentally, storytelling is the original healing device, right? It's the original thing that we could do for each other. It was listen and retell. And that's the basis of functional medicine. All the rest of it is details. All the rest of it is, you know, she's going to use andrographis and I'm going to use, you know, ampicillin or something. You know, I mean, those are details. They aren't that important. But we get so caught up in the details. The real goal here is live in compassion and inspire compassion and people get better.
Beautiful. Yeah, look, it's. I think everyone who's played a role or is in part of this community can echo that. And you know, just think back to an event we did last year with Charles Eisenstein, where he really helped our community to see that there's more to functional medicine succeeding than just functional medicine succeeding. The net result of thousands of practitioners delivering compassionate care will be an impact on society, in a society that, you know, whoever you voted for in November and however you feel about it is in dire needs of it. Christy, you were just in England with all these practitioners of the AFMCP from all over the world. I mean, this is not just an American problem, and it's a really amazing American solution. Pilar, just one question I want to come to. So if you had that $250 million and now you're a media planner, where do you see media coming around to this kind of conversation? Because I saw just on the New York Times today, they're telling to back off chiropractors. Chiropractors are actually pretty useful. That was today in the New York Times. Didn't have time to put it on. And we should all apologize for being mean for the last 50 years. Where do you feel that, you know, where do you feel that there's the most, the green shoots in content covering the movement that you like?
Well, I do think that there's a lot of promise in smaller scale media companies producing better and better content. I think because it has become more democratized in general, the media industry understands that some of the most creative and fun and popular media is coming out of, you know, not like mega TV stations, but people making YouTube videos and things like that. And I do think that there's a lot of promise there. I don't know that if you wrote me a $250 million check, I would know exactly how to spend it in this moment. But I would think the first thing I would do is find genuinely passionate people who want to tell these stories and want to do the research and want to deliver customer audience-driven content. as opposed to creating a gigantic machine that's designed to attract more eyeballs so that they can sell more ads and then find sponsors to help make them the next $250 million. I think if we spent $250 million actually educating people on how to get healthy and connecting them with each other in ways that support them in becoming healthy, and address the real obstacles in our culture of becoming a healthy person in the midst of 97.5% of people not practicing basic healthy habits, that would be where I would start. So I think it's the way we're all spending our time and money now, probably a lot of the people in this room. But I think, you know, people who are benefactors of that kind of work, including people like Penny, who have been amazing advocates for taking a shot on really hardworking, passionate individuals who want to change the world. We need more people doing that. And I mean, as sad as it is to see, I think, primary care doctors leaving the existing system, there's always some small part of me that says, you know what? Good. The system isn't going to succeed the way it's going. So it's better to see people coming out while they still have a shred of passion and hope and compassion in them and deciding to blend themselves together with other people who want to do that work.
Beautiful. And it's not by accident that we have a naturopathic doctor, physician, journalist, and chiropractor here, because, you know, we see that if you were to add up all the functional MDs, the naturopaths, and, you know, and the chiropractors together, we're getting close to that 100,000 micro practices. That's really the goal of the evolution of medicine. And it's really exciting to see that there have been, you know, fairly sad failures in institutionalized integrative and functional medicine in the last year. But what is happening and what I can report on is that the functional medicine micro practice thing, it's happening. And it's happening fast, and it's really exciting to see practitioners coming together and building these low overhead systems and going directly for patients. Because as Jeff Glad said 2 months ago, I mean, at the forum in March, there's a whole swathe of people with these high deductible health plans that don't really know what to do with them, and we can add a lot of value to those people as well. So I just want to share my appreciation for all of you coming, in some cases a long way, to be here. Pilar, thanks for helping us find this beautiful place. Sachin, coming from a completely other country, to be here. It's been an absolute pleasure to do the Functional Forum. This is the 40th episode of the Functional Forum. I will tell everyone now a bit of a, you know, I'm not sure exactly where we're going from here, but I can tell you we're going to double down on the meetup groups. You know, such people are having transformative experiences in those groups, and we see that there are ones popping up all over the country, all over the world. So we'll be doubling down on that and really doubling down to create communities all around the world and make and reduce the barriers to entry, not just for practitioners to find out about functional medicine. We've got some really exciting things coming soon from the Institute for Functional Medicine, where they'll be reducing their barriers so that anyone can learn about the operating system that Christy spoke about. In terms of content, the host of the International Functional Forum, Dr. Rangan Chatterjee, a little bird, told me that his next season of his show, Doctor in the House, is starting on BBC One, probably in front of many millions of people later this month. So things are moving in our direction. We just have to be ready to take them. So thanks so much, Minneapolis, for an amazing show. If you want to start a meetup group, if you feel like you're ready to do it, meetup.functionalforum.com is the place to go. Our next Functional Forum is Monday, June the 5th. It's going to be coming from the IFM annual conference. It's the Evolution of Neurology. Thanks so much for being with us, and we'll see you next month. You are